So welcome to this last session. We've got three really interesting interrelated water quality papers covering different aspects of water quality. So we're starting off with Donato Patrici from ETHZ. I'm not sure whether that's in Switzerland or in Italy, but the presentation is actually about Ethiopia. And I'm really looking forward to this one. We've got some kind of water balances, looking at kind of water quality and handling issues, water handling issues and household water treatment. Then we move on to a kind of specific technology. So Hana Lokey will be presenting about reverse osmosis using solar energy in Haiti. And then in the third presentation, then we have a case study from Nepal looking at kind of the water safety plan approach to water quality monitoring, surveillance, and again, kind of household water treatment. So some really interesting interrelated aspects of water quality here, not just focusing on the technical issues, but also on the kind of wider issues of overall kind of water safety planning and monitoring. So I'll start the first presentation. And if everybody can make sure that you are muted, because unlike all the other presentations you will have been in, we can't just sort of instantly turn you all off. If there's any echo on the line, it means somebody is not muted. Anyway, I'll start the first presentation now.
I'm Donato Patrici, I'm an engineer, and I'm very much interested also in my master's thesis in collaboration with ETH Zurich, IAVAG, and SUPS University. Within the time of my master's thesis, I had the opportunity to conduct 1 month fieldwork in Awassa, where I collected more than 200 water samples. I looked for microbial contamination all along the supply line, and I also interviewed people on the water. In a collapsed caldera in the main Ethiopian rift. Awassa is 275 kilometers southern of Addis Abeba and is now the capital of the Sidama region. As also other lakes in the Ethiopian rift, also Awassa Lake is affected by high concentration of fluoride due to a natural hydrogenic watering. Therefore, the water authorities are supplying water from the mountains that are located 450 kilometers outside of the city. Thanks to these tools from Google Earth Engine, we are able to see the change in the Awassa water basin from 1984 until today. The changes focus on the increase of the linear urban areas, of the decrease of the Lake Chelaka due to siltation of eroded soil from the mountains, and also an increase of agricultural crops around the lakes. The population in 2017 was more than 450,000 people.
I think someone stopped the presentation.
Agricultural fields includes cropping, pastures, and agroforestry. By converting native forests into agricultural fields, also the process of erosion soil has increased around the lake. By increasing this process of erosion, all the sediments were coming to the lake, causing an increase of the lake bed of almost 1 meter by 1999 to 2011, leading to a loss of water volume of the lake of 4%, an increase of the lake area, which is now flooding partially the city, and also this increase of the lake area also increase the evaporation. Population is also affected by this flooding. By the end of the last rainy season last year, almost 5,000 people had to move from their home because water has flooded. During my master thesis, I analyzed also the water resources from 1980 until 2015. Due to lack of in situ measurements, I use the analysis data, which is a combination of satellites and other data. Firstly, I compare them at country level, and then I plot them at the basin level. I compare them with the precipitation that was measured at a washout station, and we can see the presence of two rainy seasons between April and May, and between July and September, following a dry season that lasts from October until beginning of April. By comparing from 1980 until 2015, the trends show that the rainy seasons are usually shorter but wetter, while the dry season is lasting longer, but is also drier. I also compare the evapotranspiration from the land and from the lake of the basin. Since the adjacent basins are at a lower elevation, the groundwater inflow is equal to zero. And since it's an endorheic basin, also the surface runoff is equal to zero. And all the water comes out of the basin as groundwater outflow from the lake bed. I was therefore able to compute a first order storage of water at monthly time scale by subtracting evapotranspiration and groundwater outflow from precipitation. During my fieldwork, I had the opportunity of conducting water samples analysis and household survey in two peri-urban and one rural community around Awassa. I collected more than 200 water samples all along the water supply line, from the point of abstraction, the sources, through the reservoir, water points, the point of delivery, until the point of use, the households. I used the membrane filtration technique, and thanks to the field laboratory, I was able to look for Escherichia coli and total coliforms. Escherichia coli are indicators of fecal contamination, while total coliforms are indicators of poor disinfection. With the household survey that I conducted in parallel with my water samples analysis, I asked questions regarding the wealth demographic of the households, but also regarding water habits, perception of risk in using contaminated water, and presence of household water treatment methods. In this graph, we are able to see the state of water quality from the sources, where, as expected, we have presence of total coliforms and Escherichia coli. Then the water is pumped to reservoir, where an operator performs a manual disinfection using calcium hypochlorite powder. And then water is supplied to standpipes, the point of delivery. And then people are fetching water with jerry cans and transporting it until the households. As a result of not enough concentration of free residual chlorine at the point of delivery, we have recontamination of water during transport and storage of water in jerry cans that are not, of course, disinfected. As a consequence, the presence of Escherichia coli was found in 47% of water samples collected in the households. The results of the surveys conducted at households show that between five and six people in average live in every household, leading to problems in performing household water treatment in every day. Therefore, only 14% of households declared of using a method for household water treatment, but only 16 of them performed it in the previous 2 weeks. 16% of households had events of diarrhea in the previous 2 weeks, while the absence of diarrhea was significantly associated with the using of household water treatment, declaring of having sufficient water available for performing hygiene practices, and with higher education inside the household. The answer regarding the adequacy of water quality quantity during the year help us also validate the first order approximation of storage of water inside the basin as calculated, as said before. Therefore, people were experiencing water scarcity also when there was a deficit of water in the water basin. Therefore, from January until March and from October until the end of the year. The problem of water quality at household level and the recontamination of water is due to a mismanagement in the decentralized water chlorination and in low hygiene standards and risk perception at household level. This can be changed by providing enough concentration of free residual chlorine at the point of delivery and by providing hygiene promotion campaigns to the community. Providing a technology, which is an hardware, without a program focusing on behavioral change, which is software, will lead to a non-acceptability of a technology and non-sustainability of a long-term project. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Donato. Really interesting presentation, kind of looking at the interrelationship between the kind of overall basin water balances and the water quality and kind of household availability issues. So if you could put questions in the chat, obviously we're struggling a little bit with the technology on this call right now. I don't know if Donato is actually visible or there. I can't see him on my screen at the moment. Is he there?
Yeah, he's there.
Okay.
Yes, I can see you. Okay, you.
Okay, great. So, put questions to Donato in the chat. I was just wondering about, you started off with this big picture view of the basin within the Rheic Basin, and I wondered if that has any impact on water
quality. Hello, everyone. Welcome to the presentation on the water.
Hello.
I'm sorry about this.
Hello.
The video started playing again there. So I was wondering about the water quality issues in this endorheic basin, if there are any particular water chemistry issues that you needed to take into consideration.
First of all, as many other lakes in the Rift Valley, the main problem is the problem of fluoride concentration, which is happening in all the lakes along the Ethiopian and Kenya Rift Valley. This is so difficult to treat and so expensive also to treat that water and local authorities prefer supplying water from mountains that are 40 or 50 kilometers away from the water basin rather than treating it at the near the lake. This is, of course, the main problem. At the same time, there are also problem of pollution of the lake and of the aquifers due to an increase in urbanization, industrialization of the area without services that treat the water going outside of industrial parks or households.
So your water balances at the beginning, we're looking at the availability of supply at household level for those water balances. What is the main purpose of the kind of basin-wide water balance and how that related to the rest of the water quality study?
Sorry, can you repeat the question, please?
I was just wondering how the basin-wide water balances related to the rest of the kind of water quality study in terms of the availability. Is that because of the extreme limits to the availability of water?
Actually, it's also influenced by the availability, especially in rural areas where people don't have access to a lot of water for hygiene practices and therefore for stopping the spreading of water-related diseases. But most important is in urban areas the absence of water treatment for treating the gray and black water.
Thank you. Got comments here. There's lots of sound noise. We're trying to keep everybody's microphones off. But unlike the other sessions, everybody's got presenter rights, so they can kind of override what we're doing. I think we've got Sidi and Surrender both with microphones on at the moment. I'm going to turn those off and see if that improves things. Is that better? Yeah, okay. I think yes, we're better there. Are there any other questions from the attendees? Richard, have you been able to monitor?
Yeah, there's nothing coming through. I think probably the technical difficulties might not be helping. I've got Sidi typing, and I've been trying to sort of keep an eye on people's microphones and stuff. Because they seem to just suddenly become live. I think we've only got a couple of minutes anyway.
Richard, I would have a comment.
Okay.
Just a short, and hi Donato, nice to see you. So we worked together, but one in Ethiopia, the other in Switzerland, and I was the supervisor in his master thesis. So I wanted to point out one thing behind what Donato presented in his excellent work he did a few years ago, and he's continuing now in Ethiopia. When we talk about water quality, really, water quality can really not be judged only by eye. I mean, you cannot take a glass of water and say, okay, it is transparent, quality is okay. I mean, water quality has to be measured, really. Water quality has to be measured. You need a laboratory. And in 90-95% of all citizen development cooperation and humanitarian issues, I was in Haiti now for 2 weeks, and most of even organization, I'm talking about international organization, they don't measure quality of water because they don't know how to do it. It's quite easy to have a portable laboratory. But what Donato did was really to measure hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of water samples. I mean, to measure fecal coliforms, you need a laboratory. It's quite easy, actually, but you need to do it. If you don't measure this, you don't know what is the water quality. And we are talking about fecal coliforms, and fecal coliforms and coli are indicating fecal contamination, which leads to the major cause of disease of children, which is diarrhea. It's children below 5 in Ethiopia, but in every country, in developing countries, is diarrhea. It's the first cause of death of children below 5. And to me, the implementation of really accurate water quality measurements, I'm talking about now mainly about coliforms, and fecal coliforms, because this is the 95% of the problem there, or 98% of the problem. Then we can go into chemistry, metals and everything. But first, let's try to get rid of this fecal contamination, but we will never be able to do it if we are not going to measure. So for this reason, one of the big added values of Donato's work, and thank you for that, is really that you did in the field measurements of the water quality with a laboratory. So you used ISO standard measurement of fecal coliforms. And to me, this is a central part of, when we talk about water quality, should be a central part of this issue.
Thank you for that. Actually, that will be the theme of the third presentation, I think, in this session. So hopefully there'll be more discussion about that afterwards. We do need to move on, but there is a quick question here. Maybe if you could answer this one very quickly about the methods of household water treatment, its cost and sustainability.
So actually, household water treatment methods were not really used during the service that I did. But the only way people used to treat water was with sodium, small bottles of sodium hypochlorite called water guard. But they were using that only when there was a spread of cholera in the area, and therefore people were like kind of motivated in using it. Otherwise, daily there was no household water treatment methods performed by
households. Thanks for that clarification. Yeah,
thank you.
Sorry, that one. Okay, I think we're going to move on to the next one. And I do once again apologize for some of the technical issues we're experiencing here. We'll start the next video, and if we can make sure everybody's microphone stay turned off throughout, please. Thank you.
Hi everyone, good morning or afternoon, depending on where in the world you're watching this from. Let me introduce myself. My name is Walter Nonnemaker, and I'm a water treatment engineer by trade. And it's my honor to speak to you today on behalf of Healing Waters International. Healing Waters is a US-based nonprofit that works as a niche implementer, focusing on sustainable treatment solutions for challenging water profiles in low resource contexts. So in the spirit of this seminar, which is equitable access in the face of change, I'd like to examine together the case of a rural, low-resource community that not only lacks water access, but moreover, the sources that could potentially be used to provide access contain physicochemical contaminants that would be harmful to human health. Some classic examples of this would be coastal communities around the world where the water tables are brackish, right? They're salty or contain high TDS. Or where groundwater regionally contains arsenic or excessive fluoride, etc. These are common scenarios all over the world, and these communities globally suffer from all kinds of things, from degenerative conditions, cancers, kidney failure, etc., due to minerals and heavy metal contamination on top of gastrointestinal illness. And these situations will only become more widespread over time due to population growth, climate change, and industrialization. But how can we address this? How to navigate that fine line between the robust technology for adequate remediation and financial sustainability? It really is a conundrum, and it's even acquired a certain taboo in the nonprofit sector. We tend to think that advanced treatment is simply not feasible, not affordable in the rural context. So we end up prioritizing interventions in contexts where groundwater can be made potable only with simple filtration. And as a result, the most vulnerable communities in need of improved water are often overlooked, even by the nonprofit sector. What I want to introduce to you today is Healing Waters' experience and findings regarding the feasibility of creating access to safe water from challenging profiles, from exotic contaminants in raw water sources that require advanced treatment, and doing this even in rural settings, and our journey to ensuring these interventions' long-term sustainability. We posit that communities can be empowered to manage complex water treatment systems, even where literacy and technical expertise are limited, as long as training and ongoing support are properly managed and the system itself is optimized for use in the context. So let me talk you through our experiences and conclusions regarding this critical issue. First, to give you an overview of Healing Waters' general program and approach, Healing Waters partners with stakeholders and community leaders to establish water access and treatment solutions that operate as small water enterprises, meaning they provide water to their communities in exchange for an affordable monetary contribution, usually a family monthly quota, and that's calculated to cover the ongoing operating costs and future replacement parts for this water enterprise to be self-sustainable. Healing Waters has implemented so far 487 of these across 17 countries. So the fundamental approach is to design each intervention to both the size of the population and also to a full lab test of a water sample from the raw water source available in the region. So custom design and build each intervention. Throughout the world, we've encountered regions where the available groundwater, for example, has toxic levels of arsenic, fluoride, heavy metal. So we design accordingly. In Guatemala, we designed remediation at one site for lead that was 64 times the WHO standard, and mercury was also present. But I want to focus the narrative specifically on our experience in rural Haiti. So Healing Waters has been operating in Haiti since 2010, and 3 years ago, we identified a need to serve coastal communities that only have brackish water sources available. Since then, we've implemented 35 community water enterprises in that context, and these have been especially challenging because the technology available for removing TDS, or salinity, from water, which is reverse osmosis, is highly complex and energy intensive, and these communities have no electricity at all. Furthermore, in this context in rural Haiti, literacy and even relevant vocational training are very limited. So how can you expect a system that's robust and energy intense and requires monitoring and troubleshooting, consumables, maintenance, how can you expect that to work in a context where there's no electricity, where logistics are challenging and the people lack the literacy to operate a fine-tuned enterprise? So as you can imagine, in order to make this work, we had to contextualize the available treatment technologies and also focus on capacity building. So we have relied on reverse osmosis as the foundational technology for TDS removal at these sites where the water is brackish. But let me talk you through three ways that we've actually adapted that technology to make the systems work long-term in this context. So first, we've designed the systems to run directly off solar panels. That means the pumps are DC motor pumps. They run off variable voltage, and this eliminates the need for the batteries and inverters typical to solar power systems for pumps. In turn, that drastically decreases future replacement costs, making the system more sustainable. Secondly, we've learned that it's of critical importance to build out a water system, mounting the parts on a wall or laying them out across a room in a logical order to form an intuitive treatment train, as opposed to having the system condensed or compressed into a skid mount or essentially into a black box. It's absolutely key that operators be able to see and access each component in order to understand, monitor, and ultimately maintain them. This way, operators can actually pinpoint failures and do replacements of parts as needed, and the specialized and extensive management training is absolutely scale RO plan, but their novel use in this context, operators can write the whole thing to be standard in a municipal scale RO plan, but their novel use in this context permits feasible operations at a community scale because you're able to adjust and optimize things. But all that said, contextualizing the technology is only half the battle, maybe less than half. The other critical factor is something that Healing Waters has learned over the years through trial and error. We've learned that culturally contextualized and extensive management training is absolutely essential for community projects to remain active long term. So our team in Haiti approaches each intervention by first working to ensure commitment at the local leadership level, and then to thoroughly train designated community members in the hygienic operation and maintenance and troubleshooting of the water system. They actually engage these future operators in installing the equipment initially over 3 or 4 days to deepen their awareness of the processes and components. Then the staff continue to offer regular ongoing supports to reinforce training, help troubleshoot, provide replacement parts, and because these visits are at no cost to the community, there's actually incentive to report any concerns instead of ignoring red flags. So the big question is, does this approach really work? Can these interventions survive and sustain themselves long term? Well, nothing's perfect, we're still learning, but the performance of these interventions in coastal Haiti that we're talking about here would indicate that the answer is yes. 100% of these projects are still operating today, and across 15 projects, Healing Waters has been able to collect 86 quarterly monitoring reports showing key performance indicators. Of these reports, we see that 78% of the time, projects are setting aside their planned monthly savings quantity for future replacements. That's ensuring long-term sustainability. And the average uptime of operations is 93% of the days in each quarter. These projects are serving communities ranging from 500 to 3,000 people in size. And the product water, when it's lab tested, surpasses WHO and Haiti national water quality standards. So the data illustrates that powerful treatment systems can be managed sustainably even in low resource communities. One catch or condition that comes out of our findings is that subsidies in the ongoing tech support may be appropriate and equitable as part of bringing clean water to all. In our experience, ongoing support at no cost to the community has been key in maintaining viable, safe water service and avoiding those starts and stops. So we don't think that contradicts self-sustainability. We think the sector needs to reassess what it means for a project to be self-sustainable to ensure undue burden is not being placed on the most marginalized populations. So simpler, lower cost solutions may be appropriate in certain contexts, but for water sources that are brackish or contain exotic contaminants, comprehensive treatment solutions are necessary and feasible. The takeaway we'd like to leave you with from our own work is that communities can be empowered to manage complex water treatment systems, even in very low resource settings. Thank you so much for your consideration.
Okay, that's great. Thank you to Walter. I will, if you're just activating your computer, that would be great. And Hannah as well, if you're there.
Yeah, and I know Walter is one of the few that was listed as a attendee, so I don't know if he has the control to operate his own mic.
I think he may do now.
Yeah, I think I received permission.
Yeah, okay, great, we can hear you. Okay, so if anybody who's listening could put questions in the chat. I have a few. I mean, you kind of tackled this issue towards the end when you mentioned about subsidy and kind of rethinking the whole concept of subsidy, of sustainability in this context, with subsidy being kind of necessary. I mean, my first question was going to be not just whether you can keep these systems sustained, but whether full cost recovery is ever even conceivable with an RO solar system. And then the second one, which is one that you didn't address, but the other obvious issue about RO systems is, of course, the waste product and what you do with that. So if you could perhaps start off with those, and hopefully there'll be some more questions generated while you're speaking.
Thank you. I'll briefly field those questions, or at least summarize what my response would be. So for there to be full cost recovery with an RO treatment system depends on the size of the population being served. Obviously, you gain economies of scale with a larger population. And it also depends on the level of economic development and therefore how much water money people are able to pay for water by volume. Once you hit a certain threshold of a population being small and remote, and of low resource context, full recovery in our experience is no longer possible, which is why it's important for the nonprofit sector to focus on covering the initial capital to empower these communities so that they can at least cover ongoing costs over time.
Okay, great. But the other question was about the waste product and how you handle the waste product from the RO process.
Yeah. So how RO concentrate needs to be handled really varies by context of rural versus urban and also by scale. But at a community scale coastal project, essentially what you have in your waste product is concentrated sodium CDS. So you can run it back off onto a beach.
Okay. So in that coastal setting. So we've got some questions coming in here from Sidi. How do you ensure that the quality from the RO filtration system meets the standards set by the country or WHO, and what's the operation maintenance cost of RO, and how has it been managed by individuals?
So the best way to spot check or frequently monitor the performance of a reverse osmosis system is with instant TDS readings. You measure total dissolved solids, and there's digital meters that can do that multiple times per day. As long as you've calculated the design of your system correctly, the TDS readings serve as a proxy for the removal of other ions and contaminants. So if you know that you have, say, fluoride in your water, you should know how much of that fluoride you're removing based on having done the calculations of the membrane's performance, and then by proxy understanding the membrane's integrity over time with TDS readings that can be done essentially instantaneously by the community. So the operation and maintenance of a reverse osmosis system would vary so much, again, by the context, by the scale, how big is the community, how many membranes, how big are the membranes, how big are the pumps. There's not really numbers that I can summarize as will be the case for sort of a, you know, a standardized predefined unit. These are more kind of water system builds. But the general approach to any given project is to initially build a bill of materials. You size out all your components. And then based on that, we do what's called a Capman X analysis, which means we look at the expected shelf life, the expected life duration of each component, the replacement cost of that component, and then we normalize that over a period of 30 years and look at how much financial contribution per household per month would be necessary to sort of create a cash flow. And then we train the community leaders in sort of that business plan so they know that they're always accumulating enough cushion of cash on hand over time so that when, say, that membrane or that pump, you know, does need to be replaced typically at 10 years, there's going to be enough cash on hand to do so. And the numbers will vary by context, but the approach is generally to do a Capman X analysis and business training up front with the local leadership that's going to be empowered to run the project or with the water committee.
Great. Thank you for answering those questions. Richard, can you see any more? I don't think there are any more.
No, there's none more, only those ones from Citi.
Okay. But I'm sure if anybody wants to follow up on RO systems and lessons learned from Haiti. And one last question that maybe I would like to ask actually in this context is we often hear about RO in Haiti, and obviously there's a particular reason with high levels of salinity and kind of coastal settings why it's necessary in that particular context. But do you think, have you looked at the wider applicability of RO, or is it something that you think should stay very much in this very particular kind of niche where it's kind of really your only viable option?
So there are other forms of water treatment that are equally effective at removing pathogens, equally effective at removing organic compounds and contaminants, nutrients, etc., even heavier ions that are much, much more energy efficient and have lower ongoing operating costs than reverse osmosis. And also, you could argue, produce healthier water in the sense that they don't cause, you know, ion flux, pH reduction, and they don't provide people with essentially desalinated water. So they're still going to have the natural, you know, organically colloidal magnesium and calcium and other healthy minerals. Some people, I think, make too much of a big deal about that and say, like, no, we have to prohibit RO. And there are definitely cases where the water is brackish. There's levels of salt and, you know, salinity that literally are damaging people's kidneys. And by far the most feasible way to remove that is with reverse osmosis. So our stance is that we would want to use a system with things like ultrafiltration, which is much, you know, more energy efficient, activated carbon for organics removal, cation ionic exchange resins, etc., in cases where there are not things like salinity that require reverse osmosis.
Okay, great. Thank you. Thank you for that clarification. Very much a case of horses for courses. No one size fits all solution for all water quality issues.
We've got time for one more quick question.
Okay, is there another one?
There's actually two in the chat from Matthew at United Purpose. Do you think such option is not more adapted for urban contexts rather than rural or remote ones? If you can just quickly summarize that.
I can jump on that really, really quickly. I mean, like Walter was just saying, you know, there's other options, and you want to take the one that's going to be safe consistently, but get the job done. And where there is high salt content, that often can be remote rural contexts. We do have projects, and we have partnerships. Jibu is specifically one of our partners in more urban settings where this technology can be useful. But as Donato was saying in his presentation, you know, there are places where you'd have to go 40 or 50 kilometers to get to water that's not suffering from some of these biochemical contaminations. So sometimes this is the most feasible treatment, even in remote rural settings.
Great, thank you very much. Really interesting presentation. Thank you so much for that. We'll be moving on to our last presentation. As someone's put in the chat, it seems like the entire UNICEF Nepal team is present on this in this session. So we look forward to this last one, looking at the kind of water to safety plan approach, water quality monitoring and surveillance in Nepal.
Dear all, greetings from Nepal. My name is Surendra Babu Thakal, currently working with UNICEF in Nepal. Today, I'm going to present a paper which is about water quality improvement in Nepal, a game changer for Sustainable Development Goal 6.1. On behalf of my colleagues, Tameez, Dandiram, Arunita, Rakesh, and Bisho, I'm going to present this paper today. Let me start with swearing the drinking water status in Nepal. As you can see in the slide, the coverage on access to basic water is 95%. Improved water, which is available on premises, is 76%. And improved water, which is free from contamination, is only 24%. And the most important, according to the definition of Sustainable Development Goal, SDG 6.1, access to safely managed water in Nepal is only 19%. Meaning, water quality is a big issue in Nepal. Therefore, water quality improvement could be a game changer to achieve the result. . 80% of Nepalese have access to improved water, which is available when needed, and 76% have improved water, which is available on premises. This means Nepal is really doing well in two of the three indicators for safely managed drinking water indicator. The third element, however, is the drinking water free from contamination is very, very weak. About 75% of the drinking water at source are contaminated with E. coli. This is from the recent multiple indicator cluster survey done by the government of Nepal together with UNICEF, and the result was published in 2021. Some of the contributing factors for this poor quality water are low priority on water quality by the people and by the government, inadequate mechanism for water quality monitoring, and inadequate enforcement of water quality standard. There is also a lack of awareness on water quality issues, and the perception of the people is that the drinking water from improved source are always safe. These are the issues. To address all those issues, as explained earlier, a systematic approach of water quality improvement is required. And you can see in the slide, the four pillars could be a game change for quality water, quality drinking water in Nepal. These already have been piloted in Nepal, and it is ready for scaling up. The first pillar is about provision of policies and financing, which says a costed sector plan, guidelines, and protocols for water quality and standards are to be prioritized by the government. Second pillar is about system strengthening and capacity building. It mainly talks about operationalization of the plans and policies, developing and building capacity at all levels, including availability of supplies, human resources required for water quality tests, etc. The third pillar about piloting water safe communities and demonstrating the approach as a model for scaling up. And the fourth pillar, here you can see, is the advocacy. It is very, very important to do for scaling up any initiatives that have been, that has been tested, piloted, and found useful to make impact at large scale. This slide is about water safe community. While I said water safe community, this is an approach for achieving SDG 6.1. In brief, water safe community initiative is a systematic approach and pathway to practically demonstrate achievement of SDG 6.1 at community level. There are preconditions to be met before certifying a community as water safe. The major ones include, as you can see in the slide, is in achieving open defecation free status, water quality conforming the national standard, sustainability of the water systems, and functional mechanism of water quality monitoring. Here, I'm going to tell something about the processes that is to be followed for water quality monitoring. Water quality monitoring mechanism is the key, where the local government commits for establishment of the testing facilities, build capacities of the personnel required for water quality, and the records of the tests are verified by independent team, the team of experts, so that a community qualifies for meeting the national drinking water quality standards. And the local governments monitor the water quality periodically as defined by the water quality monitoring mechanism. Following the approach as described earlier, a total of 49 communities have already been declared as water safe communities in Nepal. Guidelines and protocols are developed and are followed. And a total of 24 municipalities have already been started implementing it. Following an approach as described earlier, those communities who have already initiated the water quality monitoring mechanism have tested more than 1,000 or near to 1,000 tests in piped water system and near to 2,600 tests in hand pumps. And the results are here. And the result demonstrates and it confirms at final stage of declaring a community and at any time of monitoring, water quality meets the national standard. This is how we can say in Nepal is a demonstrated approach for meeting SDG 6.1 and improving water quality as a game changer in Nepal. Thank you very much.
Great, thank you for that last presentation. Hopefully, yes, fantastic. We've got Surrender, we've got Okay, Ahmad. Excellent, thank you. So any questions, please put them in the chat. So I'm keen to understand a little bit about the overall picture of the kind of water safety planning approach. And you've explained very well about the water quality monitoring surveillance side of things, but how does the kind of feedback loop then work to bring about the changes necessary to make those improvements once the problems have been identified?
Okay, I can come in. So here, I think this climate sensitive, this planning, you know, water safety planning is critical. So I think this is the first step, you know, to be triggered at the community level, you know. So the communities needs to be facilitated, you know, to identify, you know, potential risk, which is going to contaminate, you know, the water, the drinking water system. And then this is, you know, the whole cycle. So I'm not going into the detail of each of the steps, but there are more than, you know, six steps. So they have to identify there is, and they have to come up, you know, with the action plan, how they are going to address, you know, the future contamination of the drinking water sources. So the community develops their plan involving, you know, everybody in the communities, including the women and also school children. And then their responsibility, you know, is to implement, you know, the water, this water safety planning into practice. So to make sure, you know, the water is safe. But then I think the final outcome, you know, of the water safety, this planning is to really test, you know, the water. Unless you test the water, you know, you don't know whether the water is safe or not. So for that purpose, I think in Nepal, we have built, you know, a community-based water quality monitoring system, and as well also independent at the government level. So there is a protocol to do the testings, everything, and then they will finally lead, you know, to the water safe community. So basically what was happening, you know, previously, our focus was water safety planning, capacity building, implementing it, but not, we were not focusing, you know, on the real outcome of this climate sensitive, you know, water safety planning. So I think the question is very important. So if you need more, we can provide, but that's it at the moment. Thank you.
Thank you. It looks like several people are typing, but just as a follow-up to that, I was wondering whether by introducing this so much more monitoring, did you find that there was a contradiction, if you like, between perceptions of water quality and what the water quality data were showing?
Yes, exactly. You know, this is a perception issue, you know, is everywhere. So what happened, you know, like many of the communities, you know, they implemented the water safety plan, you know, and they thought that, you know, the water is now safe. But then, you know, there was the testing, you know, conducted really, you know, together with the communities. And then, you know, in many instances, you know, the water quality was found to be contaminated. And then they did, you know, what is contaminated? Again, you know, they did a thorough kind of, you know, inspection, investigation. And then, you know, in some situation, they found that, you know, even at the intake level, you know, there was some source of contamination. So then again, that led to the, again, you know, implementation of the water safety plan in cycle. And finally, you know, so the community cannot declare unless, you know, they confirm it. And then again, you know, it's a continuous process. It's not a one-time job, you know, you test the water quality, it's done. No. So this has to be done, you know, periodically. You have to ensure that, you know, all the time water quality is safe, and then you have to create confidence, you know, on the users. Otherwise, you know, like the perception, sometimes they think that the water is safe, but sometimes they think that, you know, it's dirty, it's not safe, but in fact the water is safe. So we have to have, you know, evidence of the water quality testings, you know, on the ground. Thank you.
Thanks. Okay, we've got a few questions that come in now in the chat. You may be able to see those as well. So Julia saying, I have seen in other contexts that there sometimes is more awareness and monitoring efforts from water ministries for chemical contaminants versus biological fecal contaminants. Did you see this as well in Nepal? Any thoughts on why so, or implications of this?
Yes, I think this is, you know, I think sometimes, you know, awareness is too high. But on the ground, you know, there is no action, you know, how to improve, you know, the water quality. Sometimes, you know, it's beyond the scope of the communities, you know, to address the issues. In Nepal, I think what we are doing, you know, is we are also doing, you know, the testing of the chemicals, priority chemicals. So this is done, you know, one time at the beginning, including the iron, you know, arsenic and other thing. But the major focus, you know, the data shows here in Nepal, you know, like 80%, you know, of the water sources, they are contaminated with E. coli. And then in some region, you know, we have arsenic issues. So some of the water safe community we did, you know, it was, you know, I think mostly contaminated by arsenic. So that was, you know, the major problem in Nepal. Some areas, you know, we have fluoride. So I think the main experience, you know, we should not only focus, you know, on the E. coli, also not giving priority to the chemical. So we have to take, you know, a holistic approach based on what are the issues, you know, on the ground. Thank you.
Thank you. Yes, I noticed that you presented some data about arsenic, and having worked quite a lot in that myself, was wondering which particular technologies you were depending on for. Did you try arsenic removal, or were you changing sources? I don't want to take away from other people.
Okay, so in Nepal, you know, the arsenic has been, you know, a big issue for the last, you know, 10-20 years. So a lot of people, you know, they tried, you know, household water treatment. But the major lesson learned, you know, from us, you know, here also in other countries, I think if there is an alternate source is available, you know, switching, you know, to the alternate source is a better option. So if you introduce, you know, this filter at the community level, then you have to provide, you know, the maintenance issues, the operation, replacement, and the NGOs, you know, do some work, and then they forget the community and they are using the filter, but the filters are contaminated. So this is a big issue. So for us, you know, better, you know, to do the switch of the sources is available. So in the worst situation, you know, we are going for the treatment. Otherwise, we are not encouraging, you know, the treatment. Yeah, thank you.
I 100% agree with that. Okay, so Mathieu is asking, can you give some examples of actions taken by the communities? Sometimes we know local institutions lack fundings. How do they manage the lab?
Okay, so at the community level, you know, so there is a big component on the sustainability. So which include, you know, revenue generation to take care of the operation issues, including, you know, purchase of the basic, you know, water quality testing. So here, I think the household metering system, you know, in those water safe communities has been introduced. There is a systematic approach, you know, to collect, you know, revenue from the household, and then the management committee is there. And then, you know, they use, you know, the funding, you know, to get access, you know, to the water quality testing kits. And they have also done, you know, the training, you know, on the water quality. So here, you know, we are not talking of sophisticated, you know, water quality equipment. So in Nepal, we are following, you know, a ladder approach, you know, to the water quality equipment. For example, at the community level, you know, you cannot expect them, you know, to do E. coli tests. But at least we have, you know, this presence absence methods, you know, just to check the color. So it's about, you know, 60% correct. And then we move, you know, to the next step, you know, the dry plate testing kits. So there, you know, you don't need to prepare a media. So it's easy and it could be done, you know, by the ordinary person, you know, with some training. And then we have this portable, you know, testing kits like Woktek, Telequa. And then we have, you know, mobile van. Is the small laboratory equipped, you know, in the van, motor van. And then you can also get tested, chemical tested, and also the other component as well. Then we have the labs, you know, at the district level, those kind of things. So we are not relying only one technology, you know, for the water quality testing. Basically, it's depending, you know, on the need. Thank you.
Thank you. Yeah, it sounds very interesting the way you've got that kind of scaled approach. So another question here, how do point of use water treatment techniques affect the status of water safe communities, as this would vary with the way they are employed by individual households?
Yes, so basically, you know, in our approach, we are trying, you know, to minimize, you know, the workload on the household, you know, to treat the water. So I think in some of the situation, you know, the water is chlorinated. So they are getting, you know, the water already chlorinated is safe. Sometime, you know, it's coming from the spring. So we do this household, you know, water quality testing to make sure that, you know, the household water quality, you know, is conforming to the standard. But in certain situation, you know, if it is not possible, then we promote, you know, household treatment, like, you know, using the bleach liquid, you know, so we have in Nepal. So we call it pioche, you know, it's readily available. You just put, you know, a few drops of the liquid, you know, in the water. And then also boiling, some of the common methods, you know, usually we promote. Thank you.
So how would that affect the state? I think the question is asking if you're reliant on household water treatment, what do you then declare the status of that community to be?
Yeah, so basically, I think I mentioned, you know, early, it's not a one-time job. So initially, you have to go through the protocol test, even the household water, you know, to be tested, not only at the system level. And then if it qualifies, you know, then you are declaring it water safe. And then you have to do, you know, the again and again. So for us, I think recently, you know, we have again been to those communities, you know, with third party. And then we found that, you know, almost 90%, you know, of those water safe communities declared, you know, about a year ago, 2 years ago, they are still, you know, water safe. So I think the communities have been rigorously trained, you know, on this issue. So clearly they know that, you know, if they're not, you know, doing the proper treatment at the household level or the system level, so they are not going to get the water. So the, in nutshell, I think is the water quality testing. You know, if you have a mechanism, then you can see your water is safe at the household level. If not, then I think it's a perception issue again here. Yeah. Thank you.
Do you have a certain threshold then that would mean you're satisfied that that community is managing the water safely in terms of the application?
Yes. So
do you have a kind of cutoff?
Yeah. So here.
90%.
Yeah, cutoff. I think we are thinking, you know, it should be over 90%.
Okay.
So is it, yeah. So that is our target. Yeah.
You set your target for that to qualify.
Yes.
Okay. Yeah. Very interesting approach. Thank you very much for that presentation. I don't think we've got any more questions there in the chat, and we're already over the end of this last session. The plenary will be starting soon. So on behalf of everybody who's presented, not just in this session, but in all the previous ones, thank you very much for your participation. And after the plenary, I guess we'll be just looking forward to seeing you at the next WEDC conference. Please do use the feedback forms. We've been asked to plug this. So we really want your feedback about the conference as a whole. Do look for that. I believe it's on the notice board. Is that right, Richard, on the notice board page? I think so, from the foyer. It should be accessible, but we'd love to hear what you thought of the conference. Once again, some apologies for the technical issues, but I think we got there in the end on this session. So it was all loud and clear. Thank you very much indeed.